we have Whitney Kerr Sr. who's going to discuss real estate here in Kansas City. And to shorten the introduction for Whitney, many of you know who he is the who's who in commercial real estate in Kansas City. I'm going to welcome Whitney Kerr Sr.
City. which now is UMKC's law school. And I got a job because of that thesis. I wrote the thesis on the Missouri Urban Renewal Corporation Act, 353. And Dave Hughes was active on the Schools and Scholarship Committee at Princeton, and he asked me to serve on that committee since I had gone there on a scholarship. And so he asked me about my thesis, and that asked to borrow it. He showed it to Byron Schutz and Bill Campbell and Mr. Jones, people who were the head of the old River B. Jones Company. And I was hired at age 23 as a salesman. I was going to law school at the same time, and finished up law school, passed the bar, and was in the Air Force for 3 years as judge advocates. But I fell in love with the real estate business. And so about that time, the interstate system was beginning to take place, and we were trying to sell land in downtown Kansas City at 12th and Main for probably $75 a square foot at that time. This was right after I got out of the Air Force in 1962. And the interstate highway across 435 for College Boulevard is in that Johnson County area at that time was not open. It wasn't open until 1969. But when the area began to open up, I was involved in selling George Gordon's farm at Roe and Knoll, College Boulevard. And it was called the Dingley Dell Farm. And Jonathan, I'm sure you may have been out there. It was right across the street from Crosby Kemper Sr.'s farm there, which later became Fox Hill. But anyway, Mr. Gordon hired me to sell that for him. And we sold the first site there to Yellow Freight for 50 cents a square foot. And about that time, I also handled a deal for the relocation of Allstate. And that was about, as I recall, about $20,000 an acre for that land. So the Metropolitan Life, for whom we had acted as a mortgage correspondent, wanted to build an office park in Kansas City. And so I was at the right spot at the right time, one of the four young partners at Herbert B. Jones. And so the Met said, we'll put up all the money, you boys do the work, and we will give you an unconditional takeout commitment that you can take to the bank. And they won't be looking to your credit because I didn't have any. We didn't have the money that was necessary to do a project like that, but we had the Met behind us. So it was a fantastic opportunity. I assembled the land for Parker Woods in 1971, 72 for 25 cents a square foot. And contrast that with trying to sell land in downtown Kansas City at 65 and $75 a square foot in the most valuable part of the city. Is it any wonder that the city kind of emptied out? And really, if you look back on it, what I'll try to do is give you sort of the high spots of what has happened in this past 60 years. You had a perfect storm because you had the Federal Highway Act passed in 1954 by President Eisenhower and Congress then. And the first head of the Federal Highway Commission was a man named Rex Whitten, who had headed the Missouri Highway Department. And so President Truman went out of office in January of 53, and Eisenhower came in January of 53. So you had a lot of political influence in both Missouri and Kansas. And the first head of it was the former head of the Missouri Highway Department. So we got more money per capita for the expansion of the interstate system than probably any other city in the country, certainly any city our size. And that was a blessing and a curse. And I think that basically my conclusion after observing this all these years is that it's taken us over 50 years to digest the impact of that interstate highway system. Every community that was in the suburban area that suddenly had access by interstate decided wherever there was an intersection, let's make it a shopping center or or whatever. And that was the era when mixed-use zoning was not common or, in fact, encouraged. So you had an office park with all offices, or you had an industrial park with all industrial buildings, or you had an apartment project with all apartment projects instead of mixed-use development. And so if you worked at the industrial park or worked at the office park, you had to drive from wherever you lived to that. And so that was the vogue and common way of doing zoning in the early 60s. And so that's the way it was at Corporate Woods. Except for where the Doubletree Hotel is, and a little bit of retail, it's all office. And so that was beginning to present problems. And the other thing that happened out there along the College Boulevard corridor is the there was a man named Dick Kellenberg, who was an architect and land planner. He was hired by North Kansas City, and then subsequently hired by Overland Park. And when we had the land all assembled for Corporate Woods, we worked with Dick Kellenberg. So I take some of the blame for one of the big mistakes that was made in that area. None of us dreamed in 1971, when we were putting that deal together, 45 years ago, that we'd have the exodus of office space from Kansas City to the suburbs of Johnson County that occurred. And that's why they call it College Boulevard, because the junior college out there was on about 120 acres, rolling hills, surface parking, lots of trees, very, very low density. So the density that was recommended by Mr. Kellenberg, and we all went along with, was 0.28. And that was later changed to 0.32, which means that if you wanted to build a 32,000 square foot building, you had to buy 100,000 square feet of land. And that wasn't a problem when the land was for sale at $1.50 square foot, because it meant then that you bought 100,000 square feet of land for the 0.32 FAR, and that would cost you $150,000. Divide $150,000 by 32,000 feet, and your cost of land per square foot of the building would be $4.74. But what happened is that it was like having a governor on your car, your new Lexus that has a 400 horsepower engine, but the car only goes 60 miles an hour because of the governor. It ignored the fact that certain pieces of property were worth a whole lot more money than others. And so what happened when the land went to $11 a square foot, the cost of land per square foot of the building area went to $35 a square foot. So what happened is that in order to rent buildings at competitive rates, two things happened. And I learned this lesson from the late Frank Morgan. He said, Whitney, there are only two variables in building an office building. One's the cost of the land, and the other is whether you build a quality building or you build a cheap building. Taxes are going to be prorated the same, management fee is going to be the same, interest rate of the loan is going to be the same, utilities will be about the same. So what happens, it drove everybody to buy cheaper land and build cheaper buildings in order to build to a low rent and to be competitive. And that's what's happened in Overland Park. So we began to have urban sprawl on steroids. And so now you've got College Boulevard, and you've got 119th Street, and you've got 135th Street. And in many parts of the United States, the sick pup in real estate are suburban office buildings. Well, I began to be concerned about this over 30 years ago. And I sold my interest in Corporate Woods in 1981 and was persuaded to come down and try to put together 23 acres where the Performing Arts Center is. And this perfect storm came about that I mentioned, came about for several reasons. One, you had the interstate highway system. Two, you had social engineering with FHA, and they wanted to build houses for the returning veterans after World War II. So the FHA loans very much encouraged the development of suburbs, but did nothing to preserve the existing housing stock in older sections of the city. And then not only did it do that, but it also required, if you were a person, a black person, and you wanted to buy a new house, it had to be a subdivision in the suburbs that specialized for blacks. Well, they were almost non-existent. So you created an isolation of the market racially, but it moved the white middle class into the suburbs and didn't do anything to maintain the suburbs. I mean, the urban areas. Second thing that happened, or the third thing, was the school desegregation cases, which caused a huge white exodus. So all those things combined to basically kind of drain out the center part of the city. Now, today, I'm pleased to say it's an entirely different situation. And when I started putting the land together for the site there at 16th and Central, where the Performing Arts Center is, there, and then that involved 60 separate transactions. And the first piece of property that I bought cost $3.50 a square foot. And I'm very proud that in putting that 23 acres together, there was not one penny of subsidy. And I borrowed the money, and I had a partner in the project to begin with named B.B. Anderson. And B.B. got into a financial problem building a building over in Tennessee. He came to me one day and said, I've got to get out of this deal. He said, I have been told by my bonding company I can be in the real estate business or I can be in the construction business, but I can't be in both. So I said, well, I borrowed so much money I can't even borrow enough money to buy an ice cream cone. I borrowed up to the hill. So I said, I'll have to look for a replacement partner, and Ian. So I made 38 full-blown presentations trying to find somebody who would be my partner. And I was very fortunate that my son, who was had gone to Vanderbilt and was a classmate and a fraternity brother with Ross Perot Jr. And so sometimes fate can do amazing things. Ross came up to Wichita to look at an airplane, and he and his wife decided to come to Kansas City to see the Christmas lights in the plaza. And one of Whitney and Ross's Vanderbilt classmates happened to be in Brooks Brothers and bumped into Ross and said, what are you doing here? And he said, well, we came up to see the Christmas lights and we didn't call anybody. And so Fritz Thompson, a lawyer here in town, Whitney's classmate and Ross's classmate, said, well, Whitney's having a party tonight. Why don't you come? So Ross and his wife came to Whitney's bachelor pad over on Rock Hill Road. He wasn't married in those days. And so Ross told him that his dad had just sold EDS to General Motors for over $4 billion cash. So Whitney, being an alert young man, said, what are you going to do with that money? He said, my dad is trying to find a partner. And so that was one of my lucky days. And so one thing led to another, and so the pros came in. And I was having a hard time with some projects that I had been working on that got subsidized and ended up over at between 11th and 12th Main to Walnut, AT&T Pavilion. And so that project was sold to them for the same price that I had offered to sell them the land over there south of the freeway. And certain downtown interests said, we can't afford to let that building move out of downtown. So that was sort of the climate that I was in. And but anyway, the pros said, well, we'll come in. And so they put up $5 million. I had a 25% interest. They had a 75% interest. They said, we don't want to tell anybody about this for a while. So for 6 months, I kept buying property and looking to figure out where I was getting money. And that was a lot of fun. And and Jim Rieger had loaned me the money. And at one point, I called up Jim and I said, Jim, I don't know how I'm going to pay you back. And I said, but I will. But at this moment, I don't know, you know, where the money's going to come from. So he was not too excited to hear that. So I asked the pros, and I said, well, there's one person I want to tell about this, and it's Jim Rieger. So they said, well, that's fine. So Jim Rieger was very relieved. But anyway, that project ended up being full of complications. We had to get a bill passed in the House and Senate and signed by President Reagan to relocate the Federal Armory there on Broadway at 16th Street. And then Jim Tierney owned the old General Tire building, and Jim sued me and sued the KCCID and said that Judge Coburn had exceeded his authority in giving us condemnation tires on Jim's building. And 4 years later, the case having gone to the Missouri Supreme Court, I won the case in the circuit court. The Court of Appeals reversed the case, and Lowell Smith and my attorney said at the time, Whitney, I think you've had it. Chances of getting this case in the Missouri Supreme Court are just about zero. So I said, well, Lowell, I don't give up easy. And so I contacted myself, the Redevelopment Authority in St. Louis, Springfield, Kansas City, and the decision of the appellate court absolutely gutted the Planned Industrial Expansion Authority legislation that was on the books in Missouri. And so the Missouri Supreme Court took 9 cases that term, and 2 of the 9 cases were my cases, and we won. Charlie Blackmore wrote the opinion. And so we were the first test case for the Planned Industrial Expansion Authority. And so later on, I got sued by a man who was crushed in a demolition of one of the buildings down there. So all the things that happened, it was a very stressful time. And fortunately, fortunately now in hindsight, the Perot Hotel deal that we worked on long and hard was turned down by the city. And so at that point, the Perots were very upset, decided to leave Kansas City. And we went ahead and I started the efforts to get the property sold, and I sold it to Julia Irene and Kaufman. And what's interesting is that Julia paid $25 a square foot for that piece of ground. It was $19,050,000. And then she turned around and sold the land north of 16th Street to 670 for $53 a square foot of the city, and made the site for the Performing Arts Center almost free. And since that time, we've been involved in sales downtown that are a stone's throw away from that, that are right at $100 a square foot, and there are properties now in the area. I think the most valuable property in the city is between 670 and Crown Center. And the reason I say that is that in terms of new development that will occur, I'm confident that it will occur. I think it will occur south of 670 because the blocks are larger, the streets are wider, and there are much less expensive buildings to take down. To assemble a large site inside the loop is very difficult. A lot of people don't realize it, but it's the oldest plat. That was platted in 1850 by Colonel McGee. And then when we began to have sewers and water lines, they came down in the alleys. And so you took already small blocks and diced them again. And the other thing is that the hills in downtown make construction. Retaining walls are required for excavations on the hillside sites. Very, very expensive. For example, the site there where the American Riverford building is, that retaining wall was just a $2 million expense right there. So I'm very bullish about downtown and the resurgence of land in downtown and land values. And I think that probably the most significant thing, there's a great book that I recommended to a number of people, written by a senior editor of Fortune magazine, a woman named Lee Gallagher, and it's called The End of the Suburb. And the suburbs aren't going to go away. That name is really a little misleading. But what it means is that the sprawl is probably going to be arrested for until our population surges a great deal more than it is right now. And what's happening is there's a new infill movement that's kind of reminds me of the out movement that I described earlier. But what's so interesting to me is it comes about because of a change of attitudes of the young people. And millennials are much more open to diversity. And I think that that's a very good thing for our cities. So if you look at the people who are coming down here and living in these loft buildings, they are young people who, I think, when they decide to get married and have families, I think many of them will be moving into the close-in older suburbs, and you'll see more and more teardowns. And so basically a replanting of the garden. So with a little time that's left, I'll be glad to answer any questions. Carl,
just one question from Carl. We're running a little bit late on time. And Whitney, would you mind staying a few minutes for those who may need someone to come up and ask you some questions?
Sure.
Okay. Carl, go ahead.
Whitney, thanks for your presentation today. We continually hear again and again about the east side, east of Truce. What's the future over there? Look down the road a decade away or so and tell us what you see there.
Well, I think that eventually the locational advantages of many of those tracts of land will come into play and be to their advantage, the advantage of the area. In fact, if you look at what's going on out northeast and the connectivity of the center core of the city to northeast, and like the spokes coming into the center wheel hub, I think that same effect will take place there. And if you've been over to see Beacon Hill and over around the medical center, there's a lot of very attractive, good development. So I think that's going to happen. Yes?
One more.
Other cities have the same kind of sprawl that we have, which is pretty typical.
Yes, because of these governmental policies affected the whole country. So. In fact, what's so interesting is that the Urban Land Institute recently had a meeting and they talked about 2,600 regional shopping centers in the suburbs of the United States that are sick, dying, or dead. And so a lot of those infill redevelopment sites are great opportunities for our city. And I think what's going on in the Circuit Complex on 87th Street, 95th Street is a perfect example of it. That's happening everywhere. We had 10 regional shopping centers in Kansas City, and 8 of those are either gone or are going. So you've got 2 of them left. I'm not talking about the Plaza or Zona Rosa or Lima Town Center. I'm talking about the enclosed mall type centers. And the only 2 that are viable right now and really doing well are Oak Park Mall and Independence.
Whitney, thank you.
Thank you very much.